If you have your Bibles with you, we'd ask you to turn to the book of 1 Chronicles. 1 Chronicles 16, and we're going to begin reading in the very first verse. 1 Chronicles 16, in the very first verse. The Bible says, "So they brought the ark of God and set it in the midst of the tent that David had pitched for it. And they offered burnt sacrifices and peace offerings before the Lord, before God. And when David had made an end of offering the burnt offerings and the peace offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord. And he dealt to every one of Israel, both man and woman, to every one a loaf of bread and a good piece of flesh and a flagon of wine. And he anointed certain of the Levites to minister before the ark of the Lord and to record and to thank and to praise the Lord God of Israel. And Asaph the chief, and next to him was Zechariah and Jael and Shemiramoth and Jael and Mananah and Eliab and Benaiah and Obedim and Jael with psalteries and with harps, but Asaph made a sound with cymbals. Benaiah also and Jehaziel, the priest, with trumpets continually before the ark of the covenant of the Lord. Then on that day David delivered first this song to thank the Lord into the hand of Asaph and his brethren. Give thanks unto the Lord God, unto the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the people. Sing unto him. Sing psalms unto him. Talk you of all his wondrous works. Glory ye in his holy name. Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord." Amen. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face continually. Remember his marvelous works that he hath done, his wonders, and the judgment of his mouth. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your watch care. We praise you for all that you do for us. We praise you for meeting with us from time to time at your choosing and at your own bidding, Lord. We know it's all under you. We pray this morning that we've came with a spirit of obedience, with a spirit of interest, and a desire to hear it from you, Lord. We pray that you would bless your holy word to the hearts of the hearers, Lord, and we'd be faithful to give you the praise for it. Lord, it's in Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Amen. Now, we'll be preaching this morning, glorify the Lord when he is near. Glorify the Lord when he is near. And most of the time, let me say, most of the time the nation of Israel did not, and most of the time we do not. And that's not any criticism, because that is the nature of the flesh. And as I was studying this and reading this, what I have found is most of what we do is really to glorify self and not glorify God. And we have to be very cautious with that. We have to be aware of that we are in the right spirit. And, you know, believe it or not, some people like my preaching. And it's very easy to get in the flesh, "Oh, brother, that was an unbelievable message." Well, that's not the reason that I preach the gospel. If you can sing and somebody just comes away and is blown away, be very careful.
Amen.
Be very careful. And so we, as the Lord's people, most of what we do, it tends to be more about the flesh than it does about the Lord. So when he begins to talk about praising the Lord, there's a great deal involved, because that doesn't happen a whole lot. Now, back in the first verse, the Bible says, "So they brought the ark of God and set it in the midst, or the middle of the tent that David had pitched for it." Now, I want you to know a couple of things about this. First of all, this was their second attempt to bring the ark back to God's people. And the first time, if you'll follow that, David had made this huge, grandiose parade, and he went down through there buck naked and dancing and praising God. And what happened is the ark fell into the hands of the enemy. And many times what we do, all it does is predispose us to losing the presence of God to the enemy. You know what? Sometimes church gets boring. Believe it or not, I was on that side of the pew more years than I've been on this side. And it does get boring, and if you're not honest about it, don't tell me that you don't think that, because every one of us have sat there and it's like, when will he be done? That's approaching it the wrong way. And David approached that first attempt in the wrong way, and he fell flat on his face. And one thing, he didn't consult the book on the means to get the ark back. And once he did, it was a great and wonderful success on the second time around, because he followed God's formula and putting it where it needed to be. Now, I did want to throw this in, because we've been studying the tabernacle in Adam's class. This is not the wilderness tabernacle. Here it says that he pitched another tent. It was separate and apart than the original. I don't know if it had worn out, or if it was gone, or maybe he just set it aside for a while. But it wasn't in the original tabernacle of the congregation. It was in a separate place. Then he says, and they, meaning the whole nation, and they offered burnt sacrifices and peace offerings before God. Now, I want you to see that this was a time of worship. This was a time of lifting up the name of Jesus. This was the time of lifting up the name of the Almighty God, Jehovah. And that was their mind of thinking. They weren't there for self. And we have to be very cautious that we don't approach this time in the thinking of self, but rather in the thinking, hey, I'm here this morning to praise God. I'm in here to lift him up. You know, a lot of times we come to church with the thought, what can I get for myself? And we do need encouragement. I'm not minimizing that. But when you come and say, hey, what can I get out of this for me? You're coming for the wrong reason. This is our time for worship. And we need to lift him up. And what I've found is every time I come in the right frame of mind, I leave full. I leave happy. I leave in a state that the Lord has blessed me greatly. Now, I want to go back and just catch the very end of chapter 15 to get what was happening. Because when we get in the right frame of mind, don't think that everyone is going to be happy. And don't think that everyone, even of the congregation, is going to be happy. In verse 26, the Bible says, chapter 15, verse 26, just above that a bit, and it came to pass when God helped the Levites that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord, they offered 7 bullocks and 7 rams. Now, I want you to see what had to come to pass is that when God helped, they had made their own attempt. They made an empty attempt and failed miserably in getting the ark home. But when God helped, you know when the preaching is good is when God helps. You know when the singing is good is when God helps. You know what will be effective in teaching when God helps. And you know what? This is the reality. He don't have to do that. We've about convinced ourselves he does. But that's the hand of Almighty God, and you can't demand it. And so we see then, as they were making this second attempt, that God was with them. Verse 27, and David was clothed. What a blessing. He wasn't running around naked anymore. He was clothed. He looked modest. He was approaching things in the right way. And David was clothed with a robe of fine linen, and all the Levites else that bear the ark, meaning they were clothed as well. And the singers and Chenaniah, the master of the song with the singers, David also had upon him an ephod of linen. So they're all dressed, they're all doing their job, they're all in their place, doing exactly what God gave them to do. Verse 28. Thus all Israel brought up the ark. Everybody. All those that involved. If all they did was walk behind it and say, "Blessed be the name of the Lord. We're bringing it home. It's coming back to Jerusalem." Everybody was involved. Now, if you want to experience the Lord this morning, you've got to be involved. You've got to do your part. And if you sit there like a bump on the log, you know what? You know, you're going to leave here in about the same situation you arrived.
Right.
And so we see that everybody had their part in the things that had to be done. Now notice what it says in the rest of verse 27. Thus all Israel brought the ark of the covenant of the Lord with shouting, and with the sound of the cornet, which is a wind instrument, it's kind of like a clarinet, and with trumpets and with cymbals, making a noise with psalteries and harps. Now, I want you to see, it didn't say that they were in tune. It didn't say that they were just perfect in what they did. All it says is they made a sound. They were playing as they marched along. And if they understood music a little bit, they were doing their job. They were going down through there. The Bible says some of them were just shouting. They were rejoicing in the Lord. But now notice verse 29. And it came to pass as the ark of the covenant of the Lord came to the city of David, that Michal, the daughter of Saul, looking out a window, saw King David dancing and playing, and she despised him in her heart. Now, listen, when you get right with the Lord, don't expect everyone to be doing somersaults. His own wife despised him. His own wife was the problem. His own wife had the potential for bringing him down.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So, you know, and you know, if you get that, it said everyone was behind it and shouting and praising. You know what? Michelle was sitting at the house. You want to be blessed if God show up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Arrive. You know why Michelle was home boiling her own juices? Because she's at home. And you know what? I've seen people come to church and boiling their own juices too.
Yeah.
And so we see that, excuse me, not everybody was that involved. Verse 2. And when David had made an end of offering the burnt offerings and the peace offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord. Now, I want you to understand this. David was not really qualified in that sense to offer these praises to the Lord. And there was two reasons. Number one, he wasn't in the right lineage. And number two, he had blood on his hands. He was a murderer. He was a warrior. He had killed lots and lots and lots of people. But you know what? The very same thing happened when the temple was just first set up. Because you see, Moses did it too. And Moses was a murderer as well. And so we have to come to this conclusion. There's no reason for you not to do it. You know what? Don't get hung up on your memories. And don't get too hung up on your regrets. Because they'll bring you down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so we see then, we see that David did this first, and David accomplished what he was supposed to. A man of the tribe of Judah instead of the tribe of Levi, he did what he was supposed to do. Verse 3. And he dealt to every one, that means boys, girls, women, and men, and he dealt to every one of Israel, both man and woman, to every one a loaf of bread and a good piece of flesh and a flagon of wine. And you know what? It was time to celebrate. This is in the modern day, or back when in the 70s when I was a boy, this was dinner on the ground. It was time to celebrate. It was time to give the Lord the praise. And he, listen, that was no cheap expense for about 4.5 million people. And he fed every one of them. Got it down, prepared for them, and said, there's you some. And there's, you know what that says to me? If you want to consume it this morning, it's here. And if you want to leave here, and you want to leave here hungry, you've got to refuse it.
Amen.
You know what? Michelle didn't get hers, did she?
No.
The reason why she's back at the house pouting, wondering what Saul would have thought about all this. And so we see that if we want our portion, it's present, it's there for us. And if we want to refuse it and be upset and be mad, you can do that too, but you won't get the blessings that you should. Verse 4, and he appointed certain of the Levites to minister to the ark of the Lord and to record and to thank and praise the Lord God of Israel. Now, excuse me. He has his portion done. He praised the Lord as the leader. He gave out the blessings of the meal, and then he turned it back over to the Levites. You know what? You know what that says in the modern day? Every one of you are getting a portion this morning, or you're refusing your portion, whichever you choose to do. And as some of you are doing your parts, David did his part, and then he says, hey, I'm going to turn it back over to the tribe of Levi. That belongs to them. The Levites were the priests. The Levites were responsible. And he says, I've got mine done now.
Yeah.
You take her back. And, you know, you may like me or you may distrust me. I don't know. But what this says is when the day is done, I'm responsible for the Testament, not you. And so we see that he give back exactly as he was supposed to. Then we get in to some personal responsibilities, and I can butcher these names really well, but it begins in Asaph, the chief, meaning the chief priest, and next to him Zechariah, and Jael, and Shemiramoth, and Jael, and Manathani, and Eliab, and Benaiah, and Obededom, and Jael, and with psalteries and with harps. But Asaph made a sound with cymbals. Now, I want you to see a couple of things. First of all, that there was more than one instrument. There was one, you know, a good Baptist church has this one. And a lot of times, you know what? Others are frowned upon. Primitive Baptist people have nothing. Campbellite people have nothing. Now, the reason why, and you have to weigh this out in light of the scriptures, it doesn't say anything about it in the New Testament. Whether we want to do cartwheels or whether we don't, that is where they get it. But let me say this, it's not prohibited either. It's not restricted either. And so that's why I think it's okay. But if you go to a church service and somebody's strumming the guitar, don't you look down your nose at them. Because that's an instrument too. So everybody had their job and everybody had their thing to do, and blessed be God, they were doing it. They weren't trying to pass the buck. They weren't getting it off to somebody else. And excuse me. And if you read it, and if I understand this correctly, see, Jael had more to do than anybody else. That wasn't three different Jaels. It's one. And so, you know what? It may fall on you responsibility-wise sometimes to do it all. You know what? I have pastor friends that song lead, teach Sunday school, and preach the gospel. Everyone. Now, I'll say this. I have to believe this. Somebody's not stepping up to the plate. But they do them all. And you know what? They seem as happy as they can be. You know why I don't bother them? They come there with the right attitude. If this is the three jobs I got, I'm going to give it everything I've got. And they do them. And so we see then, as the Lord's people, that they came with an attitude to serve God. Verse 6, and Benaiah also, and Jehaziel, the priest, with trumpets continually before the ark of the covenant of God. Now, I want you to see that within the ark of the covenant, that they were constantly there doing these trumpets and giving this song. And it says continually, I don't know much about the trumpets, but I do remember them from when I was in high school. And they're very loud and they're very shrill. And you know what? We get sick of hearing them. A trumpet can have an irritating sound to it. I like it most of the time, but I could see where it wore on you. You know what I'm saying? You know, preaching sounds pretty much the same again and again and again and again. Don't you get tired of it? Don't you get tired of it? By the foolishness of preaching. And that's how people are saved. They're not saved by vacation Bible school. Don't have nothing against it. But you know what they need to do at vacation Bible school? They need to preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
That's what needs to happen. And so we see then that they were doing their jobs. If it got old, if it got monotonous, if it got difficult, they were still doing the jobs that was beset on them. Then on that day, verse 7, David delivered this psalm to thank the Lord unto the hand of Asaph and his brethren. Now Asaph and his brethren were praising the Lord. They were giving him great glory and great honor. And old David slipped him a new song and said, how about this one? You know what? It's nothing wrong with someone requesting a song. And I've been in some churches, if somebody makes a song request, you think, you know, the Pope had died. That's okay. There's no problem with that. See, slipping, how about this one, Asaph? I just wrote it last night. It's hot off the presses. No problem with that. And in fact, as we began to read it, it gave great glory and great honor to God. And so we see that the song that David gave Asaph, it begins, give thanks unto the Lord. Give thanks unto the Lord. That was the first line in the sonnet. The first line in the psalm was give thanks unto the Lord. Bless His name. Praise Him for who He... You know what? You know what? I thank Him for arriving safely at New Testament today. I thank Him that He's given me another day above the sun that I may go on in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank... You know what? Before I left this morning, I had two little old pancakes that I ate for breakfast. It's all I wanted. But you know what? I didn't have to go scrounge for them. They were in my house. And I thank God for it. They were thanking God that they had the ark back down at the house of God. You know what? When the Holy Ghost shows up, we ought to thank God. We ought to praise Him for who He is, give Him great glory and great honor. Thank God that He met with us this morning. And so we see that David began by the recognition of who God was and thanking God just for being God. Give thanks unto the Lord. Call upon his name. Now, can you imagine and set the scene in your mind? You know what? Giving thanks to the Lord, praising him for who he was, lifting him up, just because he is who he said he was. Give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. You know, I've often wondered this, certainly in the Baptist church, if we just began to call upon his name. You know what the name of God is? It's Jehovah. Jehovah Jireh. You know what the Lord's name? His name shall be Jesus. Nothing wrong with that name. If you began to say, bless him, Jesus, help him, Lord God, give him what we need to hear, you'd think you'd wound up and was a couple of streets over down at the Pentecostal church. But this is what the Bible says, right? We need to be faithful to the Bible and not men, right?
Right.
And so we see then as the Lord's people that David had a mind to praise the Lord, to give him credence for who he was. Make known his deeds among the people. In other words, let me tell you what the Lord has done for me just this week. Let me tell you how he satisfied my longings. Let me tell you how when the rain was coming down, that there was a roof above my head. When it got a little cool with dogwood winter, I had a blanket to wrap myself up in. God has been so good to us.
Amen.
See, David had an understanding of that. Because, see, David had been on the run before. David had lived through times that wasn't so good. And at this point in his life, Absalom had not yet rebelled. So he had hard times still to go. But at this time, he was praising God.
Amen.
He was given the Lord great praise and glory for who he was at this time in his life. Singing unto him. Now, if you underline in your Bible, you get that one marked. Sing unto him. Don't you sing for my benefit. Don't you sing for the benefit of New Testament church. You sing unto the Lord.
Amen.
Now, I want you to also see this, because some people criticize when people sing by themselves. Well, this was an individual command. Was it not? I've heard some well-meaning preachers think you have to have four or five up there. The only problem is the Bible doesn't teach that. Sing unto the Lord. You put him, when you begin to sing, and you may sound like I am, like a boxer hound, but you sing unto the Lord.
Right.
And it'll be all right. God will take care of the rest. If you put him first and sing unto the Lord, it doesn't matter what anybody else thinks. It doesn't matter if you're on key or if you're on pitch or whatever the problem may be. If you sing unto the Lord, that's a command that David gave his people. Sing unto him. Sing songs unto him. Talk ye of all his wondrous works. Now, again, he's given a number of commands. He says, sing some songs to him. You sing unto him, and you find a psalm that you like, and you sing it. You give him great glory for it. And then it says, you tell stories about him. You let people know how he's brought you through. You tell people in the middle of the midnight when you could find no peace at all that the Holy Spirit came by and satisfied everything that you needed. You tell people about that. You tell him how he brought you through finances, illnesses, when there was seemingly no way at all.
Amen.
And he gave you what you needed. You give him that praise. And you know what? It's the way I understand the text right here, he wasn't talking just about in the congregation. Listen, they was fixing to have dinner on the ground, and when they got done with the meeting time, he says, you get out there and you tell them what God's done for you. Now the problem is today, a lot of us have no experiences like that. It's not because they don't happen, it's because we don't recognize when they happen. You know why you had something to eat this morning? The goodness of God.
Right.
You know why you had clean water in that tap when you turned around this morning? Because of the goodness of God. You give Him praise. You lift Him up. If you don't have anything to praise Him for this morning, but listen, every one of y'all is looking at me sitting in a pew. You know what? We didn't have to go up and meet in Matrix's stall this morning, did we?
Right.
We had a place to come to. Nice place. Lord, to be able to give Him praise for that and say, look here, this is what God's done for me today. Just today. Not all the goodness through my whole life, but just today, this is what He's done for me. Verse 10. Glory ye in His holy name. Ever thought about that? Do you know the names of the mighty God of all heaven? Jehovah, Jehovah Jireh, I am. We need to give Him praise for that. You know what? You talk about an all-consuming name that seems so simple. You tell Him I am, sent you.
That's right.
You know what I am is? And I remember old Miss Sue Link trying to beat this into my head. Couldn't quite get it. I am means to be. I remember it for as many times as she repeated, it means to be. You tell Him that everything sent you. You tell Him that the one that's always been sent you. You tell them the one you can depend on has sent you. I am. We ought to be able to. You know, the problem is today, we almost seem to think it's weird to say anything but God and the Lord, don't we? And the reason why the devil wants you to be down and be stupid spiritually. But he's got some wonderful, wonderful names. And we need to learn them. And we need to praise him for them. We need to lift him up, by his given name. I've got three names. Larry Wayne, when I'm in trouble, and Larry Wayne Lafferty. Whenever, you know, in the United States, you know your legal name is however it appears on your Social Security card. And for years and years, I thought my name was Larry W. Lafferty. And when I was getting ready to graduate from UT Martin, I went down to the admissions office and they said, this is how your name will appear on your degree. And it was Larry Wayne Lafferty. I said, I don't like my middle name. I've never liked my middle name. And then I gave my son my middle name. And they said, I'm sorry, that's how it's on your Social Security card. So that's one way I'm known. What about you? And my brother and my sister, and I don't let nobody else call me this, call me Lair, L-A-R. And I only thing I can come up with was they's too lazy to put the E on it. But that's some different names, and we should know them and be able to praise Him and give Him glory by His given names. Glory ye in His holy name. Let the heart of them rejoice and seek the Lord. Now, the end of verse 10 there has a key in it. It has a reason behind it. It says, let the heart of them rejoice. Now, I've seen people that get out and they run the aisles and holler and hoop. And what they're doing is seek attention for self. Now, I don't mind it if God's in it. But what you need to be sure is you're giving Him praise and not yourself.
That's right.
And so we see that David, who understood praise and understood the presence of God probably better than we ever will, he says, you give Him, you rejoice and seek the Lord. Then he begins to give us some commands. He says, give thanks in verse 8. Call upon His name. Make known His deeds. Sing unto Him. Sing songs. Talk ye of all His wonderful works. Glory in His holy name. And seek the Lord. So in those verses right there, he gives us seven separate things to do to call upon the name of the Lord. Verse 11, he repeats one, and the reason he repeats it, it needs some emphasis. Seek the Lord and His strength. You know what you have the ability to do on your own? Nothing.
Yeah.
That's why I'm talking about these people that get in the energy of the flesh and carry on. You need the Lord. Every one of you need the Lord. And you know what? When you wake up tomorrow, you're going to need Him more than you needed Him today. So we need to seek Him. You know what we need in our nation and in our churches? We just need some old-fashioned seekers. People who would pray all night long and look and desire the face of God. That's seekers. That's people who have an interest of knowing the will of God. Knowing what God is all about. Verse 12. Remember His marvelous works that He hath done. They're called on to remember. And man, He'd done some things for Israel. He created a nation where there was none. He loved a people that was unlovable. He delivered a people from the strongest nation on earth. He had sustained them with water out of a rock. He had given them food that rained out of the sky. And you know what? They forgot most of it. And you know what? We do too. And you know why we forget? Because we don't rehearse enough. You remember this? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Thy rod and thy staff comfort me. You know why I can do that? I've memorized it. You know why I can tell you what God's done for me? It's because I've rehearsed it over and over. You know why they began to cry down in Egypt because of those taskmasters? Because they didn't remember. They didn't remember. They didn't remember what Joseph had done. They didn't remember the 7 years of blight that God brought them through when the rest of the world was starving. They didn't remember. So you may be facing a trial very, very soon. And all it's for is to jog your memory. We need that. We need to be reminded. And sometimes some hard stuff ought to come our way. And you know, our children and our children's children need to be able to remember and say, well, you know what? I wasn't alive. Or maybe I was a little boy and I don't remember it. But Dad used to tell of a time, even as a registered nurse, that he was laid off. He couldn't find a job. And God put some money in that mailbox that we didn't know was coming.
But if you don't tell it and rehearse it, it's forgotten and it's gone. So we need to do that as the Lord's people and think of the goodness that God has done for us. Last verse, number 13. Oh, you seed of Israel, his servant, you children of Jacob, his chosen ones. So he ends it by placing the responsibility right back on them. And in the church age, the responsibility is right back on us. If our children are to know the goodness of God, you've got to talk about it. If our children and grandchildren is to know the price of redemption, you have to tell them about it. If our children are to know and understand the workings of the Holy Ghost, you've got to tell them about it. They've got to know when the Word of God became routine and it became real to you. They've got to know about that.
Yeah.
You know why people quit going to church? They don't have any attachment. You know, and I understand the women are to be silent, but what I found is when people are in ignorance, they do what they understand. But I think she died in 1971 or 1972. But I remember a godly woman, Miss Anna Dennis, over at home. I'd never seen that woman. Now, I didn't understand it then, but I do now. I never seen that woman when she didn't have a covering on. I thought Miss Anna just liked to wear scarves and hats. And I remember her shouting, giving praise. She left this life, she's probably in her late 80s then. And that was in the 70s. So you know what? Being born before the turn of the century, she had seen some things. Mm-hmm. She'd seen some meetings. And you know what? I know her children and I know her grandchildren. And they learned a great deal from her. And the reason why, she told them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
She passed that along. And we need to do that too. We don't need to be ashamed to give praise and glory unto our God.
Right.
We don't need to be embarrassed about that.